Okay, Parsha Noach. So I want to share with you two ideas, two very beautiful ideas, where we again visit the Parsha of the Mabul, Noach and the flood. The Pasuk says that the whole world was destroyed. Why? It says the Pasuk in Perek Vav, Pasuk Yud Aleph, Vatishoche Sa'aretz Lifnei Ha'elokim. The world was destroyed. Vayom Elokim L'Noach, Keitz Kol Basa Balafanai. This is the end of man. Ki Mola Ha'aretz Chomos Bepneihem V'ni Mashchisim Es Ha'aretz. Now, Rashi on these Pesukim says, Vatishoches, what did they do wrong? So there were, why was the world destroyed? So there was a lot of terrible things going on. The Rashi says, Vatishoches is Loshen Erva, Vavidazora. So there was immorality, there was idolatry going on. Vatimolei Ha'aretz Chomos, there was Gezel, there was theft. And what was the catalyst? Why is the Kodesh Baruch Hu destroying the land? The catalyst was theft. Now that's a bit strange. The world had become so corrupt that there was idolatry, there was immorality, and it was theft which was sort of the straw that breaks the camel's back. Why? So I saw an answer. There's a sefer called Migdash Halevi, who written posthumously by, I think, the family, Rabbi Yosef Tzvi Duna. He was here in London, of course. That's Abba Duna's father, Dayan Aaron Duna's father. And it's a lovely sefer. And I saw the same answer in Rabbi Yaakov Bender's sefer on Chumash. And he says the following. They both point to a medrash. Take a look at the medrash, the fourth box on the page. If you're listening online, email me please at j.golker@gmail.com. I'll send you the handout. Says the medrash. This is a medrash in Bereishis Rabba, Parsha Lamdal of Simen Hay. Kol kach lomo. Why is it that the world was destroyed because of Gezel? Ki mola ha'aretz chomos mipneihem. Says the medrash, ezu chomos ve'ezu gezel. What was it? What were they doing wrong? What was this chomos, this violence, and what was the gezel? So Omer b'chanina, chomos ein eshava pruta. Chomos is when the theft involved small amounts, things which were not shava pruta. V'gezel shava pruta. V'kach hoyu anshe ha'mabul oisim. This is the practice. This is what they would do in the Dor HaMabul. One of them would bring out a big bowl of turmesim. Turmesim are beans. Imagine you go to Machane Yehuda, you go to the shuk, and people are selling lots, you know, they've got their wares out in these big stands, and people are selling nuts and beans and things like that. And a guy would come along, and he'll take a few peanuts, he'll take a few garinim, a few beans. This guy would come and take. I can't sue the guy because it's pachas mishavet pruta. It's less than that small amount. Shavet pruta is a minimal amount, whatever it is, 5p, 10p, it's a small amount. So if it's such a small amount, I can't sue the person. It's not technically theft. You, Dor HaMabul, are not behaving correctly. You're doing things, you're stealing small amounts. I will also do for you not kashur, not appropriate. In other words, I'm going to just destroy you. You're going underhand, I will go underhand. Now, let's do this Migdash Halevi. If we want to understand the depths of what they were doing wrong, and the explanation, the reason for this terrible punishment, the whole world was destroyed. In light of the above medrash, we'll be able to understand it. Shekain, ilu hayu b'nei Dor HaMabul goyiz m'shavet pruta. Had the people at the time of the Mabul been stealing a shavet pruta, hayu makum letzapas shebemukdum b'mucha, you could have hoped that sooner or later, yitnu libam lispoinim b'maseyem. They'll think about what they've done. They'll think this is wrong. How can we steal from another person? In other words, imagine. You know, you've got a teenager who suddenly gets a bit older. He's now 16 or 17 years old. And he thinks to himself, when I was younger, when I was, you know, a few years ago, I would go down to the shop and I would pinch something here and there. He would shoplift. You know, the crazy things that kids do. Not so unusual. And then he gets a bit older and he's thinking, this is crazy. So what would he do? What may he do? At one point when his conscience, is awakened, he maybe he'll think, look, I stole 10 bars of chocolates over the year, so I'll take a £10 note and I'll put it in an envelope. I'm too embarrassed to give it to the shopkeeper. But I'll put it under his door and I'll put a note, this is for the things that I've stolen. So he knows it. But that's only true if he's stolen something which is worth a pruta. If someone steals something which is not a shava pruta, he'll think, well, I haven't done anything wrong. I was in Tesco's, I stole a grape. I was in Ben Yehuda, I was in Machan Yehuda, and I just stole a few garinim. No, people do that. Says the Mikdash HaLevi, Yovinu kirah darkum yachzur b'tshuva. A person who stole an ashava pruta will do tshuva. Yoshiva sagdela shebiyodam. There's a possibility that he'll return that which he stole. Ulam me'ach vehim goz d'poch mishava pruta. But since the Dara Mabel stole less than ashava pruta, v'al pi adin lo ha'im mechuvim lahachzir, and halachically they did not have to give anything back. You didn't have to give back the garinim that you stole. So that in their own eyes, they did nothing wrong, they were tzaddikim. What have I done wrong? I haven't done anything wrong. They won't even register they've done anything wrong. There's no way they're ever going to repair the bad which they've done. Next paragraph. There's no point in waiting for the tshuva of the Dara Mabul. Shekein bor hoyas shetshuva zu lo tovu leilam. It's never going to come. Chetam hoya ba'ofen kazeh shekimat lo hosim okam letikvas tshuva. They're never going to, there's no way they're going to hope to do tshuva. Val kein, miya kodesh baruch hu, limso simohem es adin lohovi, vahovi es hamabul, limcho es kol habriyah mea pnei adam. Okay, and that's why kodesh baruch hu decided I'm going to destroy the world, because there's no point waiting. They're never going to do tshuva. They don't realize they've done anything wrong. Okay, now with that, he says beautifully, that can explain the Mishnah in Bab Metzia. Why? The Mishnah says, next paragraph, Omru. You know, we're familiar. We've got, the Gabbas had a busy season the last month. So the Gabba, how many Mishnah Berachs have they made over the last few weeks? A lot. Yeah, with all the davening. There is a concept of Mishnah. What is a Mishnah Berach? A guy gets an aliyah. So you stand up and you say, Misha Beirach Avram Yitzchak V'Yakov, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who gave a bracha to Avram Yitzchak V'Yakov, who Yevarech Es, whoever got the Aliyah, etc. There is actually an opposite of Misha Beirach, a public curse. It's called the Misha Pora. Look at this, it's the Mishnah. We don't do it, and it's not so well known, thankfully. But there is something out there. Omru, Misha Pora Me'an Shedor HaMabul or Midor HaFloga. The person, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who gave retribution, who punished the Dor HaMabul, the generation of the flood, and the generation of the dispersion, who osid leparam misha ina omid d'burah. He should punish a person who doesn't keep his word. V'lechayra, ma ha-shaychas bein chatoim, ho-rabim shal b'nei Dor HaMabul, lebein chetoi shal misha ina omid d'burah. What's the connection? Why are you punishing the guy who doesn't keep his word by saying the person who punished, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who punished the Dor HaMabul, the Dor HaFloga, should also punish the person who doesn't keep his word? Says the Mikdash HaLevi, Rabduna, beautiful. Ulam, al pi ha-mispayer, ha-dvorim nifloim. Shekein medu bekam b'mi she-chayze b'mokam sh'al pi ha-din, e-ef shalif kfus l'amad b'diburay. We're talking about a person who didn't keep his word. Legally, halachically, you can't do anything against him. He never signed the contract. So he didn't sign the contract, he didn't give the money, he didn't make the kinyan. So therefore, halachically, he's not bound. He just said something. So halachically, I can't force him. Aha. What have I done wrong? I didn't sign the contract. Yes, I committed to buy the item, to sell the item, to whatever. I didn't sign the contract. So what have I done wrong? I'm a tzaddik, I'm yosha. So too, the Dor HaFloga, the Dor HaMabul, like we said, in their eyes, they didn't do anything wrong. That's the connection. That's why it's Misha Pora, because the two are linked. The guy, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who is going to punish the Dor HaMabul because they, in their own eyes, think they did nothing wrong, and they're never going to do tshuva. So too, a person who says things but doesn't keep his word, he doesn't think he's done anything wrong. Halachically, I'm in the right. Okay, Peseda, that's the explanation. Now, so you and I may think, Peseda, we say things, we keep our words. We don't go around Machane Yehuda stealing garinim or going to the Tesco's or wherever and picking a grape and eating it before we pay for it. But Rav Bender brings the following story, which it gives food for thought. He said, that one time Rabbi Yashiv was walking, and he sees and he's stopping at the lights before he crosses the lights red, and they've got the red figure, the red man. So you can't walk. And a guy looks around, there's no cars there, he crosses the road. I don't know about you, but I'm sure I've done this 100 times. So the Rabbi Yashiv looks at this fellow and he says to him, Ritzicha, murder. You're crossing the road when it's the red man, it's the red figure. So the guy looked at Rabbi Yashiv and he says, but there's no cars around, what's the problem? He says, this time there's no cars around. He says, but if someone saw you do this, that will show a certain sort of flippancy towards crossing the road when there's a red man. And this time there are no cars around, but who knows where it could lead? Which is an interesting way of looking at things. And therefore, a person with vision can see beyond the little turmesim, the little beans, the little garinim. You can see that when society sort of chips away at human decency, and even though legally they've done nothing wrong, then that is sort of, that shows a certain breakdown in community. And with that, Rav Bender, by the way, explains a very geshmaka Rashi. If you look at the end, the pasuk says, Rashi says at the end, "V'chi ezu kasha, shadur hamabul shadur haflaga," which was worse. There were two generations. There was a dur hamabul, who, as we said, Arias, Avodah Zorah, and Gezel was the catalyst. And then there was a dur haflaga. The dur haflaga was the dispersion. They built the Tower of Bavel. They sort of built ladders to Shemayim. They rebelled against Hashem, but they weren't destroyed. So which generation is worse? Says Rashi, Eilu lo poshtu yad be'ikah. The dur hamabul, they didn't rebel against God. Ve'eilu poshtu yad be'ikah, but the dur haflaga did. Kaviyoch v'lochim bo, they tried to fight against HaKadosh Baruch Hu, as it were. Ve'eilu nishtefu, but yet the dur hamabul was destroyed. They were washed away. Ve'eilu lo nevdu min ha'ilam, but the dur haflaga weren't. So Rashi gives his explanation. But one of the explanations is, El dur hamabul hay gazlonim v'yisim riva b'neim, etc., etc. But in light of what we've said above, now we understand. The dur haflaga were openly rebelling against HaKadosh Baruch Hu. They were building towers to heaven. And therefore they knew what they were doing was wicked. And therefore there's a possibility, maybe they'll turn around and say, I was wrong. Maybe they'll do tshuva. But the dur hamabul, they were stealing less than shavah pruta. In their eyes they were tzaddikim. They did nothing wrong. And therefore there's no hope they're going to do tshuva because they're tzaddikim in their own eyes. So with that, you can answer the same question again. So really what they're both saying is that it's the culture of theft which is so devastating, and ultimately, when you chip away in a small way, in these small areas of society, then that, you know, that sort of slow erosion of decency can actually, you know, cause a society to actually fall into disrepair. Okay, let's move on with one other idea, an amazing idea. Last week's sedra, this week's sedra, they're long sedras. But they're long sedras because they contain a lot of names. Interestingly, we know there are 10 generations between Adam, Rishon, and Noach, and between Noach and Avraham Avinu. But if you look in the sedra, in this week's sedra and last week's sedra, they're recorded in a different way. And it's very intriguing. We know the Mishnah Pirkei Avos compares the two, but look at the way that the Parsha declares them. This is last week's Parsha. Vayechi Sheis, this is just one example. This is one example of the 10 generations between Adam and Noach. Vayechi Sheis Chomesh Shonim Ma'as Shona. Sheis was 805 years old. Vayoled es Enosh, and he gave birth to Enosh. Vayechi Sheis Achre Yolidu es Enosh Sheva Shonim Shmoyne Me'as Shona Vayoled Bonim Bonis. And then he lived a certain number of years after he gave birth. And then Vayukolim Es Sheis He died at 912 years. And it carries on like that. In other words, in last week's Sedra, the Torah tells us three facts. Number one, how old the man was when he became a father. Number two, how many years he lived after he became a father. And number three, the total number of years that he lived. This week's Parsha, which also lists 10 generations from Noach to Avraham, it listed in a very different way, different facts. Ve'ele told us b'nei Noach, shem chom v'yofes, b'nei yofes, goymer, amogig, amodav, v'yovan, etc. U'b'nei goymer, ashkenaz. It just lists the generations. Now there are different listings in this week's Parsha, the Ramban deals with it, but here you don't have those three facts. It just lists the generations. Why? Why is it in last week's parasha we're listing these three facts, how old they were when they first became a father, how many years they lived after that point, and how old the grand total of their life, and in this week's parasha it just lists the generations done. So Rabbi Lef said something very, very interesting. This is an article he wrote on Parshas Bereishis. He says something astonishing. There's a Rambam. The Rambam says in the end of Hilchos Melachim, it's a critical Rambam. Those people, he said, who are interested in learning what life is going to be like when Mashiach comes. It's an interesting area. People want to calculate when is Mashiach going to come. Says the Rambam, if you look at paragraph 2b, V'chol elu hadvarim v'chuyetzi bohen, lo yeida odom eich yiyu acheyu. No one is going to be able to work out what life is going to be like when Mashiach comes until it actually happens. Shedavarim susumim hein etzel hanaviim, because these things were concealed from the Naviim. Gam hachachomim ein lohem kabbalah bedvarim elu. Even the chachomim have no kabbalah, no mesorah regarding these things. Ve'ein dvarim ela ikka bedas, they're not essential. It's not the central tenets of our faith. Ve'lo yosimim ikka, don't make them central. Listen to this, here comes the key words. She'ein mevi'in lo lidei yira v'lo lidei ahava. Because it's not going to bring you close to HaKadosh Baruch Hu in terms of Yira Shemayim and Ahavas Hashem. You see from this Rambam that the whole of Torah is meant to bring a person to Ahavas Hashem, to Yira Shemayim. And if it doesn't do that, then it's not really Limud HaTorah. You see the whole purpose of learning, the whole purpose is to create that connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, with Yira Shemayim and Ahavas Hashem. That explains an interesting comment of Dan Abramsky in Megillas Esther. At the very end of Megillas Esther, the Pasuk says, V'chol ma'ase tokfu gvroso parshas gedulas Mordechai shegidlu hamelech, all the grandeur that happened to Mordechai, halehim kesuvim al sefer divrei hayom lemelech malchei modei paras. Which means, you want to know what happened to Mordechai and all the great things and the cover that he got, check out the history books of modei paras. Has anyone seen these history books? Says Dan Abramsky, you know what the Megillah is telling us? Don't think the Megillas Esther is a history book. Torah is not a history book. Torah is meant to bring a person the Yiro La'ahva. And if you want to know history, so go study the history books of Modei Paras. Maybe there's interesting things there, etc. But that's not what Megillas Esther is about. So you see from this Rambam, you see from this idea of Dan Abramsky, that Torah, Nevi'im, Ksuvim, the whole of Torah is meant to bring a person to Yerushalayim and Avas Hashem. It's not a history book, it's not just recording information. That explains our problem, the 10 generations between Adam and Noach and Noach and Avraham. Why? Because the Mishnah in Pirkei Avos says, and there it contrasts the two listings, but the parallel Mishnah in Avos to Reb Noson, look at the bottom box, it tells me why the Torah lists it. Asara Doros me Adam ad Noach, the 10 generations from Adam to Noach in last week's Edra, Lohudia kamer chapayim lefonov, to show how slow to anger HaKadosh Baruch Hu is, that the generations are getting so degenerate that they're up to Avodah Zarah and Arias and Gezel are going to destroy a world. But look how long it took HaKadosh Baruch Hu to do that. It shows his patience, his erech apayim. Shekol ha-doros sorechim es ma'aseim ha-shehevi ha-makom es mei ma'amabal aleihem. Asar ha-doros m'noach al-Avraham, however, the 10 generations from Noach to Avraham, that's different. Ma tamud lo, mel asar ha-doros ha-yusruchim es ma'aseim ha-shehevi ha-makom es mei ma'amabal. Those 10 generations are to teach us that Avram Avinu comes along and gets the reward of the last 10 generations. Ah, if that's the case, then the listings are going to be very different because they have different objectives. The first 10 generations are to teach me how Kodesh Baruch is slow to anger. So you know what he does? The Torah tells me, look how old he was when he had his first child. Look how many years he lived after he had that first child. Look at the grand total number of years he was on this earth. That highlights the point that Kodesh Baruch Hu is Erech HaPayim. But the next thing is all you need to know is there are 10 generations. Avraham Avinu comes and takes the schar of the whole lot. So just list the generations. You see that the Torah is not just a history book. It's meant to teach a person Yira Shemayim. There's a famous anecdote that Rabbi Lef brings. There was a fellow called Professor William Bertrand. He was a professor of ethics in City College in New York. And he was known to live a very immoral life, to the extent that one time the university board called him in and they took him to task. How can you be the professor of ethics if you're living a very unethical life? So he said, listen to his defense. His defense was, if I was a professor of geometry and mathematics, Would you require me to be a triangle or a compass? So just because I'm a professor of ethics, I've got to be ethical? That is not a very Jewish response. Because to teach Torah, you've got to practice what you preach. And if you don't, you're not a worthy disseminator of Torah. Simple. Mordechai Gifter used to say, we call a person who knows a lot of Torah a Talmid Chacham. What's Pshat Talmid Chacham? He is a student to that wisdom. It's the wisdom that guides that person. You can be as great as you can be, but you're always a Talmid of that Chacham. It's a simple idea, it's a very important idea. And that also, by the way, explains the difference, that the concept of Ein Mukdam Mocha B'Torah. If it's a history book, so you're going to write it chronologically. Chapter 1 is this decade, chapter 2 is this decade. But the Torah is not a history book. So of course, you know, ideally we try and go in a systematic chronological way. But it's okay to be out of order because it's not a history book. It's meant to teach Yir Shamayim and Avas Hashem. And therefore, that explains the discrepancy of the 10 generations, how they're recorded in the Torah, the difference between this week's Seder and last week's Parsha. Okay, so what have we got? Two ideas that we had time for this evening. The first is this idea of Rabbi Dunah, and also Lahav Nechaim Nechaim of Yaakov Benda. Why is it that despite there seemed to be very grave crimes in the time of the Mabul, it was Gezel which was the catalyst? The answer is because the Medrash says what they were doing wrong is they were taking less than a pachas m'shavah bruta, which means they were taking something which halachically you can't sue the person. So in their eyes, they were okay, they were tzaddikim, and there's no hope of them doing tshuva. And it's those little things which actually can sort of peck away at society, which can bring a whole society down. And that explains the Mishnah in Bab Metzia, which says that Omer Misha Parah Me'anshe Dera Mabul Me'dera Flaga Hu Asid Le Parah Misha Inu Emid B'Diburay. Emid B'Diburay, what's he done wrong? I haven't signed the contract, I just gave a word, what's a word? You can't sue me. That's exactly the point, he's not going to do tshuva. And that explains the difference between the Dor HaMabul and Dor HaFlogah. The Dor HaMabul was destroyed. The Dor HaFlogah, there's a possibility they can do tshuva, even though they're rebelling against HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And then the second idea, or left, beautiful idea, the 10 generations between Avram, between Adam and Noach, Noach and Avram, the difference in the way they're recorded highlights the point that their objectives of each one is very different. And really, to highlight the point that the Rambam says in the end of Hilchos Melachim, the Torah is meant to bring a person to Yir HaShemayim and Avas Hashem. Okay. We'll leave it there. See you.